streets of California.
It hurts. It hurts. Mm. 2007 Father's Day, and April 3rd, 2003.
Young children.
15. Both was murdered at 15 years old. Never experienced life. You know. Never understood life. But see, that's what we go through when we being misled in these streets, and as young kids, we not really knowing what we're doing. We taking up on diabolical things that we doing. We hurting our mothers, our fathers, you know. We hurting our loved ones. And there's no one there really to teach them a better lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And that's what my hope in this program here will be able to reach out to.
Because you didn't have boot camp and all
no,
that.
No, we didn't have nothing there growing up. All that's abolished, you know, from us when we tried to reach out. There wasn't no program like Ms. Greenleaf have, you know, mm-hmm. Nashville Peacemaker. Wasn't none of that around for us. But in the other community was, not in the black community. Mm-hmm.
And so, Mr. Bell, you're trying to prevent situations like this from happening to your children. Is that what are you telling them now, Mr. Bell?
Yes, very well. I don't want my sons to be victims of that. And every day I do my best to be there for them. And by me being there, you know, I try to have a structured lifestyle, you know, go to work, try to come home, help them with their homework, be in tune with them instead of me just being out doing the stuff I used to do, you know, being caught up in that lifestyle. And I want them to be better men, and by them being better men, I try to tell them, you know, don't do it like this. Don't listen to your buddies at school. You know, come talk to me because I've been there and done that. And you know, a lot of youngsters think, oh, you just old, you really don't know. No, you don't know. Mm-hmm. You see, I've been there. And you know, and it's hard when I was gone, being, you know, locked up for a period of time, you know, they've asked me like, where were you at? And I had to tell them I was on a job run or something like that. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to have to go back and do that. You know, it hurts talking, you know, to my daughter, you know, yeah, and my son through a glass. And, you know, I don't want them being that, you know, because it was one time, you know, I cried on my bunk. You know, I said, my children should not go through this, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's all from being just misled, mm-hmm, with the choices, you know. Cause you know, when you're young, you don't know no better. It's the worst experience, you know. If you don't have nobody there and the proper love to reach out to show you, instead of just beating you down, not giving you no hope, not giving you nothing to grab on. So you know, you really have to give them something to. Hey, I got something to live for. Mm-hmm. I see the light. You know, somebody's there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so Ms. Greenlee, in a real sense, the men play a significant role. That's what you were saying over the last minute that we have here. Play a significant role, and as long as we can hear their stories, mm-hmm, and I think that these two gentlemen, both Mr. Harris as well as Mr. Bill have real stories. Him talking about his incarceration and looking through the glass at his relatives and picking up the telephone on one side and they're on the other side. That's some of the things that you don't want your children to go through.
No.
And had you been able to perhaps save your children, mm-hmm, Mr. Harris, you probably would have done something different than what you've done. And so that's essentially what we want to talk about as we come down to this final segment. I mean, the final few minutes of this particular segment, and we appreciate the two of you giving us that information. And we'll be back with our audience following this very, very short commercial break. Thank you, and welcome back to the final segment of the show for today. We're talking to Ms. Greenlee and Mr. Howard, both who have given us, Ms. Greenlee has given us some excellent information in reference to an organization called Save Our Sons. And Mr. Howard has some additional information to give in reference to his own personal experiences with the death of his child. And of course, Ms. Greenlee, why don't you say some things in reference to how the fathers are able to play a significant role in terms of helping us to somehow deal with all of these problems with youth violence and murder and et cetera, and then allow Mr. Howard to give us some information in reference to his own personal experiences.
Yes, Dr. Haney, for the years that I've been out here in the community, I've seen over and over and over, even going to funerals, that it the fathers plays a huge part in being absent from our children and our youth. When we go to the funerals, everybody always come to us, but I know that for a fact that there's been fathers that have been sitting there next to the mother, but no one knows anything about them or their voice, and you're just like, oh ma'am, I'm so sorry what happened, and then you pass on. Mm-hmm. And that father needs to be touched also, mm-hmm. and say, sir, I really feel your pain, or I'm sorry this happened to you. But the fathers won't step up, and I don't know why. And I mean, I'm hoping that these men that I've brought with me today that will help bring that love forth. This young man here sitting to my right now, Mr. Howard, he's a hard working man out in the community, been out there for years. And when I got a phone call about him and his tragedy, it struck me and it really touched my heart, and I had to reach out to him once again.
Very good. Mr. Howard, why don't you tell us something about your own personal experiences in reference to this?
Well, I've been working in the community for like the last 11 years through my own organization. It's called Personal Interest in Changing Character, because my interest was personal. You know, I spent 20 years out here in these streets, you know, doing the things that we did, because we got caught up, you know, from, I went to college, so I'm college educated, but I got caught up in a lifestyle, and it kind of took me away from my family, but I still was there to raise my kids. Now, after I was incarcerated, I came out here and I had the need to just make a change for myself and these young men who struggle in life from lack of opportunity, lack of hope. And so it's been, tough 10 years, but recently that whole struggle, that whole hopelessness, that whole lack of opportunity, you know, hit home. My son, Juwan Booker, was murdered a month ago, okay? And we buried him 3 weeks ago. Okay, so even though I'm feeling the anger and the frustration, you know, I'm still out here to do the work, because these young men need to hold on to more than just what these streets have to offer. Mm. You know, these streets don't have too much to offer. You know, you need to give these young men some opportunities, some hope to do something different than what they're already doing.
And so you got a personal testimony, and as you said, the whole thing sort of came home to you when it happens, things that you've been trying to prevent from happening to youth for the longest, for the 10 years, all of a sudden you get the word that something has happened to your child. What was your first feeling in reference to that, Mr. Howard?
My first feeling was anger, frustration, you know, hopelessness, because I couldn't do nothing myself.
Because you'd already talked to him about it, undoubtedly.
I talked to him about it, and sometimes, you know, it's just the wrong place, wrong time, okay? And you know, my son was a good kid, but you know, he had his issues as well, but he had tried to make a difference in his life, you know. He was taking care of his family, you know, working, doing everything that he should do. But always, when you change, the streets don't change with you. Mm. So whatever came with that, sometimes, you know, it comes back to you. You know, it's kind of the chicken come home to roost. You know what I mean? And, you know, it's unfortunate, you know. It's a struggle daily. But, you know, I know that I can still continue to make a difference. And though I lost my son, somebody may not have to lose theirs.
By what some of the things that you might be able to say or some of the things you might be able to do, you can prevent that from happening to others.
Yes, sir.
Is that the general way that folks feel in reference to that, Ms. Greenlee? Speak to that.
Yes, exactly. You know, I was kind of out there in the streets doing this before my son was murdered, just like Mr. Howard. So, but it gives you more passion to really want to get out there to stop that next bullet for that next child, right, or just that innocent grown person that can be just coming out the door. Again, right, until we address the plentifulness of the guns that's coming into our poor, low-income neighborhoods.
Right.
We can talk about the gangs, the bad youth all day long, but we need to start also focusing back on how they're really getting these guns. I could say my son would have been still here if it wasn't for him getting, you know, them having that gun. We need to talk about why we don't have opportunities, why every time something go on in our community, it get cut, low budget cut, campsites get cut, free lunch get cut, any kind of job program get cut. Why we always be the one to get chopped down? Now, right, I'm asking everybody, the system, elected officials and all, to just come together together. And yeah, I do like the movie Tyler Perry, How About Haves and Have Nots. Mm-hmm. But see, as one of the young men said, it's an illusion that's going on, but that's a true story. And this is how the system got us living. You know, it's sad because how I can go down one street and say, oh, look at those beautiful homes. And I turned on one little block and like, damn, it's a third world country. Yeah. So why do we have to keep on being divided like that? So until we talk about socializing and socioeconomics here with our kids again, and let me just say this, Dr. Haney, when are we gonna get bold enough where we gonna start talking about this in schools, library, churches, and just in open tables at home? We don't even have dinner at the table anymore. Everybody eating over there, everybody eating upstairs, some people don't eat at home. I think until they let us start speaking on this and letting us, you know, one Sunday a month, let us come into church and talk about youth gang, teen pregnancy, drugs, all of this, guns. You know, my step-grandson would still be here. The young man had the gun. He accidentally killed him, but where did he get the gun? So until we start talking about other things other than gang member, this and that, and not the solution, we just going to keep on having these conversations.
Right. Mr. Howard, what would you say in reference to trying to convince and say some other words to our young people?
Well, the young people, they got a saying, you know what I mean, that I'm ready to die. Mm-hmm. But I want to challenge all young people to just, you know, find something that you want to live for.
Ready to live.
And live for that. You know, it's more to it than just coming out here and dying for nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, and the greatest thing out here is a lot of times these streets offer a sense of belonging, mm-hmm. a sense of opportunity, whereas, you know, we don't have no job programs. We don't have nowhere for the young men and like women to go. We don't have nothing for them to do, positive. Now, when I was growing up, you know, you always had something to do. I mean, the center state opened at like 11 o'clock. Mm-hmm. You know, now they have nowhere, no safe havens. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's just, we need to find something for them to do. Mm-hmm. And my hope is for you know, us to be able to just make a change in like young people's lives.
Ms. Greenlee, over the last minute and 25 seconds we have, do you think it would be cost effective if we could come up with some kind of programs that would prevent the things from happening that we're talking about here?
Yes, the program I'm coming up with now out of my own home, starting in my garage. I'm already starting a GED class there because I found out half of them have already been expelled and they've already been put out of alternative school. I also got a group called Straight Talk. That's meaning I'm bringing all the young men in and just straight talk about what's going on. I got another group called Back to Basics. That's bringing all the young ladies in and let them talk about personal hygiene and what's going on with them. They don't want to hear about college and fire department and all that right now. You need to find out what's going on with them. So quit talking about, I didn't get in this program, I didn't qualify for this program. We either make a dollar too much or a dollar too less. It's going to always be there. Start on your own front porch in your own living room and just get your ass out here and grab these kids and quit giving me all the excuses.
And that, you think that will have some kind of impact if we could all?
Oh, yeah. That'll have a great impact. In fact, April the 18th, I'm having a job readiness program, and